redirect Teddy by giving him that treat and praise him. You can even use a clicker, and he'll begin to associate the sound of the click with the reward, and he'll completely lose interest in going into the crotch of your guest,
okay,
right?
Okay,
another thing that
great.
You can do is, you know, work with some of your, you know, your friends or your family to practice this.
Okay.
And, you know, they can actually physically just sort of, you know, twist and redirect him so that he doesn't, I sort of had permission to do that. And between those two things, that might begin to sort of get him broken of the habit. And of course, if those things don't work, I always recommend working with a professional dog trainer.
Oh my God. Guys, David, one more time. Make some noise so that I know we can. David, welcome back to Build. It's so great to have you here. David's a dear friend of the show. He always brings us really cool animals and really cool information and guests. Congratulations. New season of Pet Talk.
That's right, yeah.
It's fantastic. Just premiered this past Friday,
right? That's right, season two. So that's Friday nights, awesome. 8 o'clock, tune in, NatGeo Wild.
That's so, so cool. New season, what can we expect? Anything different? You guys mixing stuff up? What's going on?
Yeah, so for these new episodes, we actually have some recurring segments. And one of mine is called Wild at My Door. And so, you know, I'm a wildlife expert. You know, I work for the National Wildlife Federation. And so the reason I'm on a pet show is that, you know, pets are really the animals that we have the daily exposure to in our life.
Yeah.
And they can actually be a real great window to the world of wildlife. And so what I do in this segment, you know, Wild at My Door, is talk about, you know, how to avoid conflicts between wildlife and pets, you know, and also helping people understand their pets from their wild ancestors' behavior. You know, if your cat is spraying, you know, your cat is scratching, your cat's rubbing its face, those are all behaviors that wild cats do, and there's a reason for them. Now, your pet cat probably doesn't need to scent mark or you know, do things like that. But you can understand your pet better if you understand its wild ancestors. So lots of good stuff. You know, tons of practical tips about pets. My co-hosts are veterinarians, Dr. Tina and Dr. Courtney. So, you know, if you love animals, if you want to get practical info from experts on taking care of them and how you can kind of connect with the bigger world of wildlife, watch Pet Talk.
For sure. And there's three of you, and I love the different perspective that each of you brings to the show. It makes it for a really fun show, a really thorough show, a lot of great information. I believe you've got Andre Milan doing remote segments now.
That's right. Andre Milan, who is Caesar Milan's son.
Yeah, he was just here with Caesar not too long ago. Yeah,
Andre is great. He's our field reporter. So he goes out and about and does really fun segments, and he's just a great guy too.
For sure.
Yeah.
So what are some of the things that we can expect that's different from season one that we're looking for in season two? We have your new segment.
Mm-hmm.
We're bringing all these parallels between the wildlife and our home life.
Well, again, we're trying to do some consistent segments, you know, from episode to episode, kind of news you could use kind of things, so that, again, we have a lot more practical information. And I think these new episodes, we just sort of took it up a notch.
Yeah.
You know, more crazy stuff happening in studio. I got to bring on some pretty awesome animals. Again, a lot of wildlife, and you would be surprised at how much overlap there is between kind of the world of pets and the world of wildlife. I already mentioned, you know, how to avoid conflicts between pets and wildlife.
Yeah.
So, you know, you can see me doing a segment on skunks and what to do if your dog or your cat gets sprayed. I'm not going to give it away. You have to watch the show to see it. Things like that. I got to milk a goat. It, you know, just crazy stuff.
It's a great once-in-a-lifetime opportunity.
Yeah.
So I want to ask you, you do these animal sort of segments everywhere, all over the place, and you're so great at them, and you bring such a great energy to them. How do you decide which animals you're going to bring with you? Like, do you have like a big wheel that you just kind of spin and throw a dart at it, and like, that's what I'm bringing today?
Yeah.
Like, how do you figure that out?
You know, this is a great question. I'm glad you asked. So the animals that I work with are ambassador animals. And so these are not animals that we pluck out of the wild. And they're, you know, they're animals that live at zoos and in captivity. And they're individuals, you know, that are picked because they have a certain comfort level at just being around people. You know, you can't just bring any old animal into a TV studio. And the reason that, you know, we work with ambassador animals like this is because they really help people understand and connect better with wildlife and the conservation messages that I'm trying to get across at the National Wildlife Federation. And, you know, there's a long history of folks working with ambassador animals going back, you know, 50 years, all the TV personalities that have come before me.
For sure.
And so so it really, you know, depends on what we want to talk about. So today, like you mentioned, it's spring. So I thought maybe we could bring in some younger animals, some baby animals, because pretty soon here over much of the country, you're going to be seeing baby wild animals everywhere. Now, maybe not the species that I brought on today, but so that's kind of how we picked the theme for today.
I'm really excited about some of the species that you brought on, specifically because it's not something that we'll see floating all over the place. I have a potentially weird question, and keeping in mind, there's children with us today, but is it true in the animal kingdom as well? Is it sort of a universal principle that nine months is the typical timeline?
Oh, no.
No.
It totally varies.
Gotcha. I mean,
there are species that, have 20-month gestations, and there are species that, they mate and the female is pregnant, but she delays the implantation of the embryo for like 6 months until the conditions are right. So it really widely varies across the animal world.
That's pretty intense.
Yeah.
I'm excited. Specifically, one of them we have this really interesting sort of journey that we're going to look at in a little bit. You talk about these animal segments, all the ones that you've done all over the place. You know, just earlier, we started a little late today for those tuning in live just because we had to make sure one of our friends could eat before
when you work
out.
With baby animals, they're just like baby people. They need to eat.
Yeah.
So you had to give a bottle to somebody so that she was going to be nice and content and full. So, yeah. So thanks for being flexible.
Oh, no, of course. We want to be sure that we accommodate all of our guests. But my question is, have you found yourself in a situation, like what's I guess the hackneyed way to ask it, what's the wildest thing that's happened in the middle of one of your segments?
Well, to be serious for a second, safety is obviously of utmost concern.
No.
First and foremost, from my point of view, for the animals. You know, we never want to bring any animal into any, TV studio scenario and have them be uncomfortable or unsafe. So that is at the top of my list. And then also, we want to keep everybody else safe because, let's face it, animals can be harmful or they can hurt people if they get freaked out. So so with that disclaimer, I did one time bring a water buffalo onto Conan. And
was that Conan's idea or yours?
Actually, it was all me.
Okay.
I have to own this one.
Okay.
TV, video, online stuff, it's visual, right? So you want to show some action, just kind of sticking an animal out there, oftentimes doesn't keep the viewer's attention. So I'm always looking for ways that we can demonstrate the natural behaviors of the animals that I bring on camera in a fun, educational way. I don't do stupid pet tricks.
No.
Like if I'm going to have an animal do an action, it's going to be so that I could use it as an opportunity to talk about what it does in the wild and its habitat and its behavior. So we had an opportunity to bring a water buffalo on, an Asian water buffalo, and this is actually a domesticated species.
Okay.
All across Southeast Asia, these are animals that are used as beasts of burden in agriculture. People ride them. Mm-hmm. And so I thought, well, why don't I have Conan get on the back of this animal and I could talk about how important this species is to the people of Southeast Asia. And there's actually a small wild population that's endangered. So I thought that would be kind of a fun way of really highlighting and, Conan on the back of a water buffalo. Everyone's going to watch that.
Absolutely.
Well, the unfortunate thing is that whenever you work with any kind of animal, there's always that one chance that they're going to get spooked. And that's what happened. And so Conan, in rehearsal, got on the back of the water buffalo. And it literally just kind of did that. But Conan went flying across the studio, came crashing to the ground. It was very stressful for everybody involved. Nobody was seriously hurt.
Well, Conan's a tall guy, but he's also wiry. So it wouldn't take a lot of force to move him that, honestly.
Those
animals are massive.
Yeah. And when you weigh a ton, all you got to do is flick your body.
Yeah, just a little bit.
And somebody as tall as Conan. So, of course, we didn't use the animal in the segment because we just thought that let's not do that. And we sent her back to the trailer. But the next day, Conan, being the consummate comedian professional that he is, could not let this go.
Yeah.
So the next day in his monologue, he came in and described this entire story and dropped his pants and showed the bruise that was left there. And let me tell you guys, go and Google Conan bruise and you will see this and your jaw will drop. And so,
but also to that end, do not Google Conan drop pants. I would not recommend that.
Yeah.
So,
lesson for me was, I'm first and foremost a conservationist, but I do work in the media.
Mm-hmm.
That's my job, is to, kind of take opportunities like this to talk about protecting wildlife. And in the case of Pet Talk, we talk a lot about pet adoption and just the best practices with all of that.
Yeah.
And I do try to, I have to capitalize on this amazing opportunity. And I do want to, play by the rules of the entertainment media game, but I learned a lesson there that I need to, again, really, stand my ground sometimes, mm-hmm. and say, we're not going to do that with an animal because I don't think it's safe and it's not going to send the right message and somebody could get hurt. And it might make for great TV, but this isn't Jackass.
Well,
right?
I mean, certainly not. And I got to say, one of the reasons we love having you in is because you don't do stupid pet tricks. You come in and you just bring really cool animals that are just really interesting and fun to see.
That's what I always say.
Yeah.
Like, animals don't need tricks to be cool.
Yeah.
I can tell you crazy, incredible things about any animal that we bring on here.
Yeah.
And that is what we should be focusing on. We should be looking at how amazing these fellow creatures that share this planet are, you know, and why we should make the effort in our daily lives, you know, in our even in our political lives, frankly, to make sure that we make a space for them on this planet, because it's up to us. They don't have a voice. Yeah. I'm up here speaking for them. And that's what we do with the National Wildlife Federation, and it's what the NatGeo Wild does as well.
We're gonna go to our segment in just a second. I want to ask you somewhat of a serious question. And working for the NWF, working on conservation, have you given any thought, are there any precautionary measures being taken, any movements being started in response to sort of this current administration's global warming isn't a big deal, all these things aren't a big deal, we're going to cut funding from here and here.
Yeah.
What are you guys doing on your side? Are you paying attention to that, thinking about that? And
how, oh, yes.
And what can we all do to sort of make sure that we're doing the best that we can to protect all our buddies out there?
Great question. I mean, at the National Wildlife Federation, we're a nonpartisan, nonprofit group,
mm-hmm.
and so we don't really engage in a lot of lobbying and things like that. Our focus is on uniting all of Americans for the cause of wildlife conservation. And frankly, conservation is not, it's not partisan. Everybody can get involved and care about it. And frankly, a lot of, people on one side or the other, all come to this world of conservation from different points of view, but that's where we try to focus. Now, with that said, absolutely, we're going to stand up for wildlife and we're going to be a voice for wildlife. And we, for the first time in our 81-year history, the National Wildlife Federation opposed a presidential cabinet nominee, Scott Pruitt, for the EPA. Now, we didn't win that battle, but we decided that it was important enough to stand up against somebody that didn't believe in science, didn't believe in climate change, running the EPA.
Yeah,
so
it's a bit of a disconnect.
We got them, and we're gonna keep up the fight.
Fair enough. Well, as you said earlier, safety is paramount and of the utmost importance, which is why we put the children in the front row closest to the stage. I do want to bring some of the animals out.
Yeah.
Who are we going to start with? Who's our first buddy coming
out
to stage?
Go for it.
Yeah.
Our first animal is an animal that generally gets really, really big, but
okay.
The species that I brought is a dwarf. And so let's bring them on in. And why don't we head over
here? Yeah, let's
head
over to the table. Our little
it'll be a little
table.
Bit easier to show these guys up here.
And guys, while we're doing this, we're going to, if you think of any questions, raise your hand. Jonathan and the boys will come around. We'll get you a microphone. We'll take some questions in between. Oh, my goodness.
Check it out. Yeah. So this is a crocodile. And obviously, it's a baby crocodile. The species is called a dwarf crocodile, and they're native to Africa. They only get to be about 3, maybe 4 feet long, unlike, say, like a big saltwater crocodile or an Nile crocodile or like an Orinoco crocodile from South America. Those guys can get to be, 15, maybe even 20 feet long.
Yeah.
So this is a little dwarf variety. Really cute little guy.
He actually has, I don't know if the camera's catching this, but he has a natural smile, like in the corner of his mouth. He's
well, that's one
so
of the ways
chill.
That you can tell the difference between crocodiles and alligators. And, a little wildlife nerdiness here. Technically, all of those animals, alligators and crocodiles, they're all crocodilians. It's a category of reptile. So they're related to, turtles and snakes and lizards. And all of them are technically crocodilians. So
that is
an alligator,
fantastic word, by
it is,
the way.
Isn't it?
We all just, as a group, just say crocodilian. I guarantee you're going to feel better. 1, 2, 3, crocodilian. You're smiling, see?
Yeah.
Go on. So as you were saying.
Yeah, it sounds like a science fiction species.
I know,
it?
It's
yeah.
amazing.
So... So alligators really, you can kind of think of them as a kind of crocodile. And there's a couple different species. There's the American alligator that lives here. There's the Chinese alligator that obviously lives in China. But one of the ways that you can tell an alligator from their cousins, all the other crocodilian species, is that crocodiles generally have a lot of teeth sticking out of their mouth.
Okay.
When an alligator shuts its mouth, they have a really kind of big, broad, wide mouth, and only a few of their teeth stick out. Crocodiles tend to have a much more narrow snout, and a lot more of their teeth stick out. But I want you to see the colors.
Yeah.
Let's not freak out.
Is there a distance at which my face should you know what I mean?
You probably shouldn't get too close to the mouth. Yeah.
Got it.
So the colors.
I'll be back here.
Let me see if I can shift him this way without. What's happening is that my hands are warm.
Fair enough.
And these are cold-blooded animals, and so as my hand is warming him up, he's getting more active.
Got it.
But all of these little baby crocodilians, alligators and crocodiles, are born with some color patterns on them. And those are designed to camouflage them. Because you can imagine, if you're this big, you're on the menu for a lot of different animals out there.
Sure.
And so that camouflage, when they're hiding out in the aquatic vegetation, you know, the striping and the banding helps blend them in with all of that. Now, once they get to be adult size, most uh-huh. species lose that because nothing's really going to mess with them. This species, the only thing, I mean, they do get preyed on even as adults, but the big thing that is threatening them is consumption by people, the bushmeat trade. You know, folks going out into the wild and just basically killing any animals that they can find, bringing them to market. Really complex problem, and it's one of those issues that is threatening wildlife around the world, and it really is an issue, a great example of how you kind of have to help people and deal with issues of poverty, mm-hmm. Oftentimes are how you help wildlife. So, I mean, a lot of folks are out there engaging in the bushmeat trade because they need to feed their families. So you got to solve those problems before you can save the wildlife. So yeah, cute little guy, right?
How old is this little guy?
This guy is just a few months old.
Just a few months. Yeah. And how long until he reaches his maximum size?
You know, most crocodilian species grow pretty rapidly for the first few years, and then they'll slow down at like maybe 3 or 4 years, and then they'll slowly continue growing.
Yeah.
And they do tend to grow throughout their lives, but it really does slow down as they, you know, once they reach a few years old.
For sure.
Yeah.
He's absolutely, he's awesome.
And I will say this too, speaking of you know, funny, crazy stories.
Yeah.
Alligators are pretty docile when it comes to crocodilians. And so I brought on, you know, 4 or 5 foot alligators. And if they're hand raised and we work with them as an ambassador animal, it's pretty safe.
Yeah.
They're like, you know, kittens. They'll just lie in your lap. Crocodiles, on the other hand, temperament-wise, tend to be a little bit more ornery.
Yeah.
And so, generally, I wouldn't really handle any kind of crocodile species that was bigger than this because they generally are trying to just, like, bite your face off. And so, it becomes an unsafe scenario.
Perfect.
So, I'm happy to work with this little guy because of all the crocodiles, he's probably the most docile and handleable.
Got it. Well, then in that case, kids, do you want to hold them? You want to hold the crocodile? No, I'm kidding.
No. But again, I will say this, since I'm here talking about pet talk.
Yes.
The disclaimer, again, all of these animals that I'm bringing on today, these are not pets.
That's actually a really good point.
People see an animal like this and they say, oh, I want that for my aquarium. And then next thing you know, we have alligators in the sewers, and you know, which is a myth, but
for sure. No, I apologize. My part as a moderator, I should have stressed that from the beginning.
Yeah.
These are not pets. They're really interesting, and you can draw a parallel between like a pet and what these animals in their
behavior.
But these are just really cool animals
that
should really be seen within the
left in the wild or
scenario.
Right, exactly. Like I'm a professional. I'm trained to do this. You know, I know it sucks for everybody out there, but you can't hold a crocodile even just because I can. But I will say this, you know, to make some conservation connections, the American alligator is one of my favorite endangered species success stories. This was a species that we almost totally wiped out.
Wow.
But because of the Endangered Species Act, which is a law that the National Wildlife Federation really fought for mm-hmm. and continues to fight for and is under threat right now, we were able to protect the species, protect its habitat, and now, I think it was 1987, the American alligator came off the endangered species list and is thriving.
That's
this guy's ready to go.
Yeah, let's go ahead and switch it up. While we're swapping him out, I see we have a question in the front row. I want to go ahead and take that while we get the next animal out here.
Does salt water actually have an effect on the crocodiles that make them bigger, or is it just that, like, something else?
Yeah, so great question. Animals that live in salt water, especially things like reptiles or even, like, marine mammals, they actually have to shed the salt that they end up consuming. And so that's why, like, think of, like, a sea turtle. When the female sea turtles come up on the beach to lay their eggs, people say that they're crying because they have tears running out of their eyes. That's actually when the sea turtle females are able to get rid of all that extra salt. And so crocodiles and other reptiles do the same thing. So it's just and not every species can live in the salt water. So they have to be specially adapted and have evolved in there in order to be able to survive in that environment versus freshwater. So good question.
Thank you for that. Who's our next buddy that we have?
All right, so our next guy out here, kind of a neat animal that most people probably have not heard of. It's got a kind of an interesting name. It's called a nutria.
Oh my goodness.
And we're going to let him kind of sit here, and I'm going to bring his tail up, and he's going to munch. All right, yeah, there we go. He loves broccoli and kale. So this is an animal that it's a rodent, as you can probably guess by looking at it.
Oh, he is all kinds of awesome.
Yeah,
look at him.
You can pet him gently
in
the back here. Yeah. And so this is an animal that is native to South America. It lives in wetland areas, and I kind of like to think of it as a kind of a cross between a muskrat and a beaver. Those are two rodent species that we have here in North America.
For sure.
Unfortunately, what's happened with this species is that it was brought up to North America, mm-hmm. and people started farming them for their fur and their meat and things like that. That never went anywhere, that industry.
Fair enough.
Some of them escaped, And so now in parts of the Deep South, like Louisiana, and even in places like the Chesapeake Bay up in Maryland, this species, this non-native species, has become established. Mm-hmm. And you can see what he's doing to that broccoli.
He is
chowing down on it.
How?
Well, they're doing that to the aquatic vegetation in the North American wetland ecosystems, which are not adapted to this kind of animal grazing. And what's happening is they're destroying the wetland vegetation all around, again, places like the Chesapeake Bay, which is then destroying habitat for other wildlife, and it's causing erosion, which is causing problems for the marine wildlife.
Domino effect.
Right. So this is a cute animal, I think, but also an example of a non-native invasive species that's causing really bad ecological problems. So my message for everybody out there is don't release wildlife into the wild.
Right, you never know
captive
the
wildlife,
right.
And especially if you are into like exotic pets, and you know, there are some species that it's legal to own, you know, not one of these guys, mm-hmm. But for the regular public, you know, you go to the store, the pet store, and you buy a lizard, and then you don't want it anymore, and you're like, oh, I'm going to set it free. Don't do that.
Don't do that.
Chances are it'll get eaten or it'll die in the winter, but if it doesn't, maybe somebody else did, and then the next thing you know, we have a nutria infestation. Burmese pythons down in the Everglades. This is a species of snake that can get to be 18 to 20 feet long, okay, is eating all of our native wildlife, is threatening the endangered Florida panther, of which there's only like 100 left, okay? This was a species that people had as pets. They escaped. So you don't want to be the source of the next invasive exotic infestation. And in fact, this guy is a juvenile. His parents were culled.
Okay.
They had to be killed. And so this guy survived, and now he he lives in captivity, and we use him as an ambassador animal. And he'll have a good long life in captivity, munching away at his broccoli and kale.
So highly invasive, massive repercussions, very, very bad and dangerous for the North American front. But all that being said, adorable.
Yeah. I think he's pretty
awesome.
Cute.
let's go on. Let's bring our next buddy out.
Whoop.
Oh, look at him go.
He's going for his kale there.
I think we've got some nutrition.
It's not a good segment until somebody poops.
Yeah,
it's usually on me.
I think that's our first official poop on camera on build. We've been doing this for a while.
Yeah.
Who had today in the pool, in the office pool? Who had today was going to be the day? I think it was Brad, Jay? Okay, there we go.
Can you guys bring in a wipe of some kind so we can clean this up before we bring out our next animal? So let's talk about this, right? So everybody
poops,
right?
We absolutely have to talk about this.
You know, normally we try to let the animals do their business
naturally
before we bring them out.
Yeah,
but sometimes it happens, and you know, it's part of the fun horror stories of doing this job. Is that, you know, I always joke it's not a good segment until somebody pees or poops on me or scratches me or I'm bleeding.
Right.
Luckily, it didn't get on my shirt, so that's
good. Made it out all right. Yeah. I gotta say, as far as poop catastrophes go, this is pretty low on the meter, right? This isn't bad.
Exactly. Yeah.
They're gonna come out and wipe it up. We're gonna keep going. We'll be fine.
My favorite though is the cousin of that nutria.
Thank you.
Thanks, Grant. I'm only doing this right now because the next animal I want to kind of be able to kind of hang out on this table, and I really wouldn't want him to be in the poop. So, but the cousin of that nutria is a beaver. And let me tell you, beavers, like that next animal I'm going to bring out, have a natural odor. It stinks.
Oh, really?
And beavers actually smell like human body odor. And I brought beavers into, you know, television studios with celebrities and everything, and it's really funny because people walk by my green room where I'm standing and they kind of sniff their armpits because they don't know it's the beaver. They think they have body odor. So
this feels like a really elaborate excuse for a body odor problem. That's all this is. This is just, it's not me. It's this incredibly exotic animal I happen to bring with me everywhere I go.
So this animal, any idea
what's
this
up,
is?
Bro?
It's pretty awesome, right? This is a tamandua. It's an anteater. Or the lesser anteater, as opposed to the giant anteater, which is a much bigger animal. So you can gently pet this guy on the back.
Okay.
It's pretty safe.
And I will.
He does not have any teeth.
Yeah.
If you check out his long mouth there, that long nose, as the name suggests, he's an anteater, so he eats a lot of ants and termites. So he doesn't need teeth for that. What he has in that long mouth is a long, sticky tongue with a barb on the end. So he can reach into, you know, the tunnels of the insects, the termites and the ants,
which
pull them out.
Which is all very fascinating, but I'd be lying if I said I wasn't extremely concerned about the giant claws he has on all.
So I was getting to those, So what they use those claws for primarily is to dig into the ant and termite nests.
Fair enough.
And, you know, a lot of times those are underground and in sort of underneath hard clay. And so they have to have those strong claws in order to do that. This is also an arboreal species.
Okay.
So that means that they live in trees. And so let me see if I can get his tail out here. You can hang on to that tail for a second. You can
how
feel,
so? Just like...
Yeah, just
oh, wow.
Feel that how is, powerful it is.
Yeah.
That's a prehensile tail.
Oh, is he grabbing on?
Yeah,
gonna
so
grab
they
on?
Use that as
he's
a...
grabbing on? They I said grab it on!
Right, as a fifth limb. That's exactly... So they use those claws and
letting go.
and the tail to walk around in the treetops.
How do I get him?
Yeah.
You know what? I'm just gonna pull back.
Yeah, he's really, really cute. Now, these are stinky animals. I don't know
if
you can smell them.
Yeah, I'm getting a little bit of that. Yeah, yeah, that's coming on over here.
They use that smell, actually, as predator defense because, again, they don't have mouths or they don't have teeth in their mouth. So they will use their claws if they get really, really threatened. And they'll rear up on their hind legs kind of like this. And they can do some damage with those claws, but
yeah,
that stinky odor oftentimes is enough deterrent, again, to keep he really wants to go this way.
Yeah, awesome. Let's go ahead. I think we have two more left. And also, I believe I saw a mic. Did I see a microphone out there? Is there another question? Oh, right there.
All right,
yeah.
We'll pass him back.
Yeah, while we're passing back.
Incredibly powerful animal. He's not very
big.
Yeah,
dude, look at him. He is.
It was taking a lot of
muscle.
Strength just to keep, you could see right here. There we go.
He's destined.
So yeah, really, really cool animal. Tamandua, cool name.
Tamandua, very, very cool name. Yeah. Your question?
Oh.
Yes. I have a family of raccoons living in two trees in my backyard, and they eat the cat food I leave out for the TNR cats.
Yes.
I'm wondering what I can give them to keep them away from the cat food.
Okay, so I have an answer for you, and it might not be the answer you want to hear.
Don't
and here's the answer. Don't feed the raccoons, and you probably should not be feeding the feral cats either. Big problem, stray cats. We love them. We want to save them. However, free-ranging domesticated cats take an incredible toll on wildlife. Up to 3.4 billion birds are killed every year by free-roaming domesticated cats, and up to 20 billion, with a B, other small wildlife. So that's rodents, but also insects like butterflies and lizards. So my message for you is, continue working to get cats adopted and protect the cats. If you can bring those feral cats in, that's really the best solution. But if you're feeding any kind of domesticated animal outside, you're going to attract opportunistic animals like raccoons, foxes, and what happens when you feed them is that they become habituated to people, they lose their fear of us, they stop eating their natural diet. And so what happens is that raccoon is going to come to your yard, eat your cat food, it's going to walk into your neighbor's yard, they're going to call animal control. So complicated issue, I know, but the best thing to do is not feed the wildlife at all. Feed them naturally by planting lots of native plants that have seeds and berries and nuts that support the insects. You build a food chain. And in fact, the National Wildlife Federation has a whole program about that called Garden for Wildlife. Tons of tips on how to naturally support the wildlife where you live and not get into trouble, like with the raccoons.
Awesome. Great tip. Great question. Let's bring on our next little buddy here.
All right. This one's really neat. This is the animal I think you were talking about.
Yes, I'm very excited to talk about this one. If you were following us on our Snapchat or anything, you might have seen a picture of this from backstage.
Gotta find her. Anybody know what this is?
Anybody?
What kind of animal would be in a pouch? Not a sloth. Somebody said a wallaby. Very close. A wallaby is a kind of kangaroo. What I have in this bag is a baby red kangaroo.
Hey, buddy.
Kangaroo Joey.
Hey, what's up?
So let's see if we can get her positioned
here. Yeah, let's see if we can.
So she's actually quite happy to be in this pouch because that's where she would be if she were out in the wild living in her mother's pouch. And so...
that's the thing that I thought was fascinating. I was reading up on the animals that we had coming in, and that the baby kangaroo will be born premature and then go into the pouch and hang out there for a couple of months.
Exactly, yeah. So when she was born, she was about this big. She had no fur. She basically was a fetus. She had two tiny little arms. Her eyes were totally shut. They were just two little bumps on her head. And so from instinct and scent, I think, when they're born, they have to crawl with these tiny little, proto arms through the mother's fur. They get into the pouch and they attach to the nipple. And then they basically continue growing. So it's almost like they have like an external womb, if you will. Like they're born out of a uterus and then they climb into this sort of external space that's almost like a uterus.
Nature is crazy.
Yeah, and so they continue developing in there, and they stay in there for like 6 months before they even emerge. And then around 6 months, they start to come out, and that's when they look like this, and they're like super cute.
Yeah, right? So is this, how old is this little guy?
She's about 9 months old. And at this point is when they really begin kind of exploring and staying out of the pouch. Now, they'll continue to stick their head in and nurse for a few more months. But super cute. I think kangaroos look like a cross between a deer and a rabbit.
Yeah.
Right?
Absolutely.
Let's see if we can show you one of her back legs.
Dude.
This is what allows these guys to hop at speeds of like 30 miles an hour. They can jump almost as long in one distance. We're not going to take her out because she's nice and comfy and happy in here. And she'd bounce around everywhere if we did.
Could I just
pet her? Yeah, you can gently pet her. Yeah.
Because... That's one of the perks of being up here when an animal poops.
Right.
Is you get to touch their fur.
Yeah, but, you know, really, really amazing animals.
What's up?
Many different species of kangaroo are found in Australia. This is one of the largest, the red kangaroos and the gray kangaroos. But as the audience member mentioned, there are a bunch of other species called wallabies that are also really cute, and many of them are a lot smaller. So
she is unfathomably soft.
Super
like,
soft,
it is
yeah.
ridiculously soft.
Yeah, it's like baby hair.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, but kangaroos are herbivores, so they're grazers. They're out there eating, you know, vegetation. This species is particularly adapted to sort of desert environments, mm-hmm. so they can go without drinking water for a long time. So yeah, just a really, really neat animal. And I should mention too, since we're talking about cute animals,
yeah.
that we have this tendency oftentimes to think of herbivores and or cute animals as not potentially dangerous. And you know, if you guys have seen Jurassic Park,
yeah.
the original one, you remember that scene where they're like, oh, look, it's a giant, you know, giant dinosaur. And they're like, oh, it's okay, it's safe, it's an herbivore. No, that's yeah. complete fiction. This animal, when she's an adult, could potentially kill you. She could kick you.
Yeah, is she going to get super jacked like all those ones on the internet, though?
The ones that you see on the internet are males. And let me tell you, I mean, they can be...
ripped.
Yeah, they're ripped like that because they fight among the other males for mating rights with the females, right? And so they got to fight, and they have to be strong if they want to mate, right?
It's hard out
and
there.
So if you get on the wrong side of a kangaroo, they can do some serious damage
yeah,
to you.
So no doubt.
The message there, of course, is not that that's a bad thing or that, you know, we have to get rid of all these dangerous wildlife, but
no, just
the rule of thumb is
kangaroo.
Let wildlife be wild.
These
animals are not your pets. Don't walk up to them. Don't try to pet them. Again, don't feed them and don't make them kind of associate people with food.
Yeah.
And then you won't have any trouble with wildlife.
Yeah, just leave them there.
If we just, you know, allow them to be wild. And what I always say is, It's amazing to see wildlife. Like, we want to attract the wildlife. We want to see those raccoons if we live here in North America. We want to see, you know, kangaroos out in Australia.
Yeah.
But let them be wild and let them do their own natural thing. And appreciate them with your camera from a distance. Don't try to be that jerk who gets the selfie and gets himself
right. Caught.
I'm
right.
sorry, but it's just the truth.
For sure.
Yeah.
Well, I could spend all day with this
yeah.
little guy. But I do believe we have one more animal
yeah.
that I'd love to bring out. And it is... Oh, you guys, just
here
wait.
She comes.
Here she comes. I know we had one more question. If we have time, we'll get to it. But if not, you'll have to excuse me. But this little guy right here is going to take precedent. We're going to...
Yeah. Oh. So this little nugget...
Oh. Oops.
This is why we were a little bit late, because she needed her bottle. This is a black bear. Black bear cub. She was, again, born in captivity.
Oh.
And she's going to be moving to a new home soon. She's and so...
Hung out.
While we still can, while she's tiny and cute and handleable, you know, I'm bringing her out to show folks,
yeah.
you know, just up close and personal, what a baby bear looks like. And hopefully her cuteness will inspire all of you guys out there and everybody watching to want to get involved in wildlife conservation, because this is what it's all about. You know, if we don't protect wildlife and we don't protect its habitat, you know, mom and dad bears cannot produce little balls of cuteness like this. And that would just make the world
yeah.
a really sad place, right?
For sure.
I mean, this is not a threatened or endangered species. In fact, black bears are pretty common over large parts of North America. You want to pet her? I know you're dying to.
I'm dying to mention. She's cooing. You can't tell from down there. I don't think the mics are getting it, but she's making these adorable little kitten-esque sounds.
Let's see. Well, now, she's only about 7 weeks old, and so just like a human baby, she's not very steady on her feet. I'm going to kind of hold her up
here. If we had
a
microphone and we put it close to
her. Yeah, that would be totally fine. Yeah.
Guys, can one of us get us one of the audience mics? I want to put it up on the table, see if we can get some of these noises here. It is just too cute to pass up.
But yeah, she's super cute and cuddly. Black bears, like brown bears, and polar bears, they're born in the dens when the mothers are down for the winter. And so she comes out also very, very tiny, similar to the kangaroo. Of course, now she's not making noise.
Hang on.
That's how it always works. Let's. She's like, "What is that thing on my face?" Her eyesight isn't very good yet, so she probably just.
Yeah, I don't want to taunt her with a giant black sphere thing.
But you
heard it. We all heard it. Right?
The
it was
mother
very,
bears
okay.
give birth when they're kind of in their winter dormancy, and these guys come out, and just like the kangaroo, they don't go into a pouch, but they spend the first few months of their life kind of blind and just nursing, and pretty soon here in the next couple months. Black bears will begin emerging from their dens with these little cuties in tow.
Goodness.
And they'll stay with their mom for 2 years in the wild, and then they'll go off on their own, and they'll find a mate and all that good stuff. So, but, you know, this is another species, depending on where you live, that might show up in your backyard.
Yeah, for sure.
And that terrifies a lot of people. But the reality is that though any wild animal can be dangerous, and particularly ones equipped with big claws, and you know,
even at this stage, her claws are pretty like
exactly, yeah, they're pretty
developed.
Sharp. Yeah, they're pretty sharp. You know, as long again as we don't attract them and we don't feed them, you know, get a pair of binoculars, and if you happen to be in a place where bears pass through your neighborhood, that's actually an amazing wildlife viewing opportunity. Yeah. You don't have to freak out. We don't have to go out and eliminate every last bear out there. You know, again, if we keep with bears, you want to keep your trash indoors until the morning of trash collection. Get a bear-proof trash can. And if you have bears eating out of your bird feeders, guys, you got to take your bird feeders down. I get calls all the time that people say, you know, how do I keep the bears out of my bird feeders? And you are not going to convince, you know, a 300-400-pound bear that this snack that you're putting out for the birds is not
not for them.
Yeah. So, but again, these are animals that we can live in harmony with if we treat them with respect. We make sure that they have habitat. We never try to make them pets or feed them. And then we'll have a future, again, where we'll have people, but we'll also have these amazing creatures that share this planet with us.
Ah, so amazing. David, I believe we're out of time, so I'm going to have to let you go and let your friends get out of here. I know you guys got a lot of other stuff to get to as well. Before we say goodbye, Pet Talk, I know the new season just premiered this past Friday. It's every Friday, correct?
Yep, every Friday at 8 p.m.
Yep, NatGeo Wild. People can check it out. And if you go to the website, there's a ton of great clips up there, too. Yeah. So if you missed it last week, definitely go check it out. Anything you want to talk about, NWF, National Wildlife Foundation?
Go to the website. Get involved, nwf.org, National Wildlife Federation. There's tons of ways that you guys can engage to help us protect wildlife. Follow us on social media, you know, make a donation, get political. The wildlife need it. This is what's at stake.
Got it. Perfect. Well, thank you to you guys for being a great audience. Thank you to David, and thank you to our amazing handlers for helping us with all these animals and getting them up here. Round of applause, David Mizejewski, everybody.